So we finally got a chance to see a proper Starlink string of pearls in the real sense of the word, only 5 days after launch, while they were still very close together. I happened to see them again 2 nights after this recording and was astounded by how much they've spread out since, again realizing how lucky we were. All credit and thanks goes to heavensabove.com. As they explain here, instead of the usual single placeholder prediction shortly after a launch, they now have proper guesstimate predictions, which I found are remarkably accurate. Ensure your observing site is correct and click on Starlink passes for all objects from a launch. Notice the new drop-down menu to select the specific launch you want predictions for. This is particularly useful to help separate out the numbering system, which is getting more and more confusing as more satellites go up. The drawback is that you must now check more than one launch for favorable predictions, but it is not so bad either, since only the most recent launches are worth bothering about, where the satellites are still low and bright and clustered together. As can be seen in my earlier video on how to observe Starlinks, look for bright predictions, small magnitude number, and high elevation passes. To identify a string of pearls, look for times very close together. These highlighted 38 or so satellites constituted the pass we photographed. Starlink 1205 was predicted to be a forerunner. We ended up seeing 2 forerunners. Clicking on the time gives a star chart of the pass, confirming it to go over quite high, emerging from Earth's shadow in the southwest and moving northeast. The string leader was Starlink 1220. Checking it shows that it follows a similar path to 1205. By scrolling to the bottom, you can easily check how dark it'll be. Remember that for civil twilight, the sun is at minus 6 degrees, minus 12 degrees for nautical twilight, and astronomical twilight ends at minus 18 degrees. Starlink 1233 was predicted to be the end of our string. Checking it out helps to aim the camera. The Virgo Corvus regions looked like a good spot to use as beacons to know where to aim the camera. This was where they were expected to be at their brightest. It was decided to use the same camera and lens as before. See the video linked below. The weather turned out to be partly cloudy, but luckily clear where I was pointing. If you watch this to the end, you'll see how lucky we were, since the clouds rolled in straight after the pass. A stray satellite passing through the field was a good test to check that the recording was working. The 2 forerunners followed shortly after. To our surprise, they suddenly faded right in my camera view, as if going into Earth's shadow. But they did not. About 30 degrees further along their path, they recovered some of their brightness again. And then the string arrived. The leader was actually tumbling, as can be seen by the flash pattern, meaning that it's probably non-functional. They all showed the same dimming pattern as seen with the leading two. Because they were observed shortly after launch, some were still so close together that they appeared as one blob. As another stray satellite traversed the field, 2 more Starlink flashers slid past. For in case there were more action to capture, I let the camera run a while longer, only to record the clouds rolling in, confirming just how lucky we were. Fun, I also ran an accumulative stack using star stacks, which brings out all sorts of detail you don't notice when watching a real-time flyby. In particular, see how a glint pattern developed, giving interesting information on how the sunlight reflects off certain parts of the satellite at specific phase angles. My friend Johan Leroux used his camera with wide-angle lens and stacked a few 30-second exposures for this picture. The sudden fading also shows up well here. Johan also used his Huawei P20 light set to star trails in the light painting mode to produce this picture.